Well, good morning and welcome to worship here at Bedford Community Church for this Sunday morning worship service. We begin with a call to worship from the book of Job in the Old Testament. Job chapter 5, beginning in verse 8, says this, "As for me, I would seek God, and to God I would commit my cause, who does great things and unsearchable, marvelous things without number. He gives rain on the earth," we've had a lot of that recently, "and sends waters on the fields. He sets on high those who are lowly, and those who mourn are lifted to safety." The God that we serve is the transcendent, eternal God, the creator of the universe, but he's also attentive to the cries of each person. His eye is on the sparrow, and his heart is turned toward us. And so when we gather in worship, we can be assured that he is with us, that he rejoices over us with singing, and that he delights in this time of interaction with him. Welcome to church this Sunday morning. Let's worship our God through the singing of songs of praise, through the attention that we give to his word. Let's worship him by setting a trajectory to live into the life that he died to give us. Pray with me if you would. Lord, we give you thanks and praise for the fact that you are God and that you are good. Lead, guide, and direct this time of worship, Holy Spirit. Even though the medium of video is not optimal, Lord, we believe that you can use anything and that you can miraculously interact, intervene, be present with us in this time of worship, that your word would go forth and not return void, but would have its way in our hearts and minds and lives. We thank you for this. Have your way during this worship service that you might receive all glory and honor and power and praise. In your name we pray, amen. Let me invite you to rise right where you are and let's lift our voice in worship to our great God.
We're creations suddenly articulate, with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. And from north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. We're the whole His name would burst from sea and sky, from rivers to the mountaintops, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me, oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. When every creature finds its inmost melody, in every human heart its native cry, oh, then in one enraptured hymn of praise, we'll sing Christ be magnified. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Mm-hmm. I won't bow to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice cause you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I hold fast to what is true. If the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just the doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your suffering, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory, with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing. My soul will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Be magnified in me. Thou art exalted. You are the blessing, Jesus, you are my reward. Oh, take this world, give me Jesus. Take this life, give me yours. In every season, you are the blessing, Jesus, you are my reward. Oh, take this world, give me Jesus. Take this life, give me yours. In every season, you are the blessing, Jesus, you are my reward. Jesus, you are my reward. Jesus, you are my reward.
Good morning, and welcome to Bedford Community Church. My name is Pastor Sarah Pallera. I'm the executive pastor here. We're glad you're with us. Here are this week's announcements.
Good morning, ladies. I'm just here to remind you to mark your calendars for May 13th for the women's brunch here at BCC at 9 a.m. Hope to see you.
Friends, are you interested in knowing more about BCC and becoming a member? If so, we'll have two membership meetings on Sunday, May 21st. First meeting during the 9 a.m. service and the second meeting after the 11 a.m. service. If you're interested, please reach out to Pastor Sarah. Friends, one of my favorite services of the year is Baptism Sunday. It's so powerful to witness an individual publicly declaring their faith in Jesus in front of their friends, family, and spiritual community. Also, it's pretty cool to see people get dunked underwater, right? Our next baptism service is Sunday, May 28th. If you're interested, please reach out to Pastor Sarah.
So Easter is over, and for us in Children's Discipleship, that means it's time for camp. Too early? No such thing. Our BCC camps are On the Case Part 1, Solving the Mysteries of How to Grow into Our Relationships with God. That's going to be on June 19th from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Schools are closed for the federal holiday of Juneteenth. August 28th through 30th from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. Armor of God Camp, getting kids ready for school by putting on the armor of God. And then On the Case Part 2, September 25th from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. and schools are closed for Yom Kippur. I need you, BCC. I need people to volunteer. And here's the deal. You don't have to volunteer for all three camps. Just let me know what date and area you want to volunteer for. There are also jobs that aren't on those days, like work days, buying supplies, or prepping things at home. Areas are decorating team, craft leader and craft helper, games leader and helper, story time helpers, group leaders, group helpers, tech team with the sound and pro presenter, and cleanup team. So feel free to email me at melissa@bedfordcommunitychurch.org or sign up in the back of the sanctuary. Thank you.
Thanks for being here with us this week. We're so glad that you came and joined us as we worshiped. Remember, there are four ways to give here at Bedford Community Church: online, in person, through the mail, and on the app. Have a great week.
Good morning, BCC family, and all who are joining us for this broadcast of our Sunday worship service. Today, we continue with week four of our new sermon series entitled The Pursuit of Happiness, True Fulfillment as Defined by Jesus. We live in a world centered around pursuing happiness and fulfillment, and yet it seems so very elusive. You might be surprised to know that the Sermon on the Mount from Jesus is all about living the good life, the abundant life that he defines. And more importantly, it intentionally addresses the moralism of religion that plagued first century Judaism and still is honestly a problem in 21st century Christianity. The Sermon on the Mount from Matthew chapter 5 is our text for this highly practical series about the life that Christ asserts is the secret to deep fulfillment. Week by week, we'll address core life topics that tear down moralism and reinforce the kingdom ethic which we are called to embody as followers of Christ. Through the landmark teaching of Matthew 5, we'll witness Jesus mock the religious constructs, the external religion, while simultaneously addressing the deepest issues of the human soul. Today, before we begin, let me offer a disclaimer, and please listen carefully to this. We sent this out via email. The context of today's message, based on Matthew chapter 5, verses 27 through 30, is distinctly for an audience above 13 years old. If this were a movie, it would be PG-13. So parents, please use discretion. Probably the best thing would be to preview the message, and then if you choose, to listen to it with your kids or teens and discuss it with them. It's a difficult message, a challenging message, but one that really needs to be preached against the backdrop of our current events. So let me invite you to open your Bible, Matthew chapter 5, beginning in verse 27. Matthew 5 and verse 27 says this from the English Standard Version of the Bible. "You have heard it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than the whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body go into hell." This is God's word. Pray with me if you would. God, we want to ask that that you would meet us in a really profound way right now. There are times that we come to your word and we see things that are encouraging, uplifting, enlightening. And then there are times that we come to your word and there is just stern warning and rebuke. And that's one of those times today. These verses, just four verses from the Sermon on the Mount, draw explicit instructions and directions. In essence, they address one of the deep cancers of the soul, and that is the cancer of lust. So God, would you help us today? Because what we don't want to do is we don't want to minimize what you say is cancerous. Help us to have eyes to see and ears to hear, to understand that you are calling your church out of the cultural norms. You're not causing us to leave the culture physically, but you are calling us to leave the culture morally. And so give us wisdom. We don't take the high road because we're better than anyone else. We take the high road morally because you have invited us to this. We want to be people who live holy, separated lives, that people might see us as light and hope and authenticity, and that they might follow you because of our example. God, there are a few ways that we could impact the world as profoundly as in this area. Help us today. Help us not to be offended. Help us not to be defensive. Help us not to hear something and get sidetracked for the rest of the message. Help us to take this on board. Most of all, God, I pray that I would disappear and that the Word of God would be brought to the forefront. Because every person that's watching this video right now, they're not looking for me or my wisdom or my insight. They want to hear the Word of God. And so may your Word come forth clearly, pristinely, and may it not return void. Thank you for this, God. Holy Spirit, come now. Anoint my lips that I might speak your truth. Anoint all of our ears that we might hear what you have for us. In your name and to your glory we pray. Amen. So it all began with a conversation on the way to the golf course. This was a week ago. I was in the car with my buddy who is not a person of faith. And he was lamenting all that's going on in the world around us, how much it's changed since we were kids. In particular, he was referencing a recent event in our town at a local used bookstore in which they had a drag queen reading hour for children. He ended his diatribe with these words, "How in the world did we get here?" I found it so interesting that a person who doesn't believe in God was asking a man of the cloth to help him understand the deeply broken world around us. Well, I'm no historian, but I am a pastor, part theologian, part anthropologist, part sociologist, sometimes psychologist. And I study history voraciously because I'm a firm believer that there's nothing new under the sun. So I asked him if I could take 5 minutes and just give him a background of how I believe that we got here. And I'd like to do the same for you, because the passage that we study today provides us both the reason for Jesus' grave warnings and also the tragic gravitas of what would happen if we failed to heed them. So the first thing I explained to my buddy is that his worldview, though secular in his perspective, is actually deeply influenced by Judeo-Christian ethics. As you've heard me mention before, you would do well to read a book from celebrated British historian Tom Holland entitled Dominion: How the Christian Revolution Remade the World. A secular author, Holland, unpacks the incredible influence of Christianity on the spread of Western civilization. I explained to my friend that so much of what we have come to accept as good or worthy or rightness flows straight from the Bible. It's been the benchmark of law and order in the modern West. And even as a non-believer, he readily accepted and agreed with this analysis. But then I moved on to the reality of the moral decline of the West over the past 100 years or so, focusing primarily on the United States. Now, let me be clear. What I'm about to share with you are solely my observations, but I also don't think that I'm that far off. In fact, many others are pointing to the same reality and sounding the alarms. My intent today is not to slander or malign or blame anyone or any group. It's simply to make observations and to point out how accelerated the decline has become in our nation and in our world. And so, as we rode in the car on the way to play golf, I continued my impromptu TED talk by moving on to the assertion of something called the slippery slope theory. It's the premise and logic in debating that asserts that if something happens, it will inevitably lead to something worse and worse and worse happening. Sometimes it's referred to as the domino or the dam break argument. It asserts that if you open one door, then many doors after that will be open, thus affecting unintended purposes. In circles of logic and critical thinking, the slippery slope argument is widely dismissed as error and fallacy, except when it's not, except when it's spot on. I explained to my friend that in the latter part of the 1970s, an organization founded by Jerry Falwell Sr. and other high-profile evangelical leaders called the Moral Majority was established to, through the power of influence in politics, legislate Christian morality back into the framework of everyday life. Concerned with the general moral direction of the country and on the heels of the advancing sexual revolution, coupled with the uptick of the proliferation of illicit drug use, these modern-day crusaders set out to reclaim America for Jesus and return her to God. Now, for the record, I was not a supporter of the Moral Majority. I still am not to this day. This organization was disbanded many years ago, but the sentiment of its foundation of Christian nationalism is still alive and well in these United States. While I believe that Christians should exercise their influence at all levels of society, we see from Scripture and history that our most profound influence is on a grassroots level, being the church in the highways and byways of everyday life. To assume that we can somehow legislate morality to thus turn our nation back to God is to miss the purpose of God's redeeming gospel in transforming people's lives one heart at a time. All that said, here's the problem. I have one glaring observation that I can't escape. They were right. The slippery slope argument wasn't a fallacy. It happened and is still happening. So the argument they made was simple. They said, look, if we open the door to embrace people's sexual self-identification and its requisite uninhibited expression, then what would follow would gradually become far worse and more insidious. At the time, they were lamenting the free love movement and the sexual revolution of the 60s and 70s that led to more and more sex in the mass media market. I remember thinking at the time that their assertions actually sounded like the rantings of puritanical middle-aged white men who cautioned their congregations to abstain from alcohol and movies and dancing for fear of the judgment of God. It seemed that they were holding an incredibly legalistic and moralistic line of defense, much like the Pharisees, fearful that if they lost this initial battle, that the world would immediately go to hell in the proverbial handbasket. But now, here we are, some 40 years removed. I'm not so certain that they weren't wrong, at least about the future outcomes that began seemingly so innocuously. I continue to explain to my friend that the revolutions of the 60s were a cataclysmic culture shift, and that the sexual revolution was really at the heart of it. If America lost her way at Woodstock, then what was born out of that revolution was the beast of personal autonomy through the power of affluence and excess. This, coupled with an agenda from mass media that sought to indoctrinate our society, and indeed the whole world, with a secular humanistic worldview, would give rise through the 80s and 90s to the perfect environment for what just a decade earlier would have been unthinkable. An important date is February 27th, 2004, where in the small hamlet of New Paltz, New York, the village where my wife and I would plant a church just 10 years later, became ground zero for the bastion of gay marriage in the United States. Mayor Jason West held a ceremony in the middle of town solemnizing several gay unions. Now, here's the thing that most people fail to remember. It immediately drew the ire of political leaders on both sides of the aisle. Republicans and Democrats rose up and united together to condemn it. But the fertile soil was already prepared. And now, let me be clear. In the years since, as gay marriage has become legalized across the nation, there are many people, including Christians, who believe that the responsibility of government is to provide equality and freedoms for all of its citizens, regardless of how they choose to self-identify. I'm not here to discuss or argue that. I'm simply here to ask an important question that few people asked in 2004. Where will all this lead us in the future? Well, let's fast forward to 2023. Calls for tolerance of alternative lifestyles have turned into the cancel culture of anyone who doesn't fully and wholeheartedly embrace any and every self-identified lifestyle. We're indoctrinating children with conversations about gender and sexuality that have no place in the classroom of an elementary school. We have people self-identifying as an seemingly innumerable number of different sexual and gender identities, even as animals, and flippantly changing them as they evolve sexually. Now the floodgates have opened. We're living in the reality of what we've chosen. Sexual abuse statistics are staggering. Human trafficking is a pandemic in our nation and around the world. Pornography is one of the leading addictions of our present day, with as many as 1 in 10 people in our nation admitting addiction. Polyamory, polygamy, and the like are ushered into the modern cultural conversation and gaining traction every day, and I won't even begin to tell you what is next. Suffice to say, we're on the cusp of returning to the atrocities of the Roman Empire, which finds its origins in the grooming of children through funny, seemingly innocuous things like drag queen story time. Which brings us right back to the beginning of my conversation with my buddy. How did we get here? I mean, here was a man with no faith asking a man of faith about the moral decay of society and how to address it. And after explaining the historical underpinnings that I've shared with you, he concurred that it made perfect sense. Church, it's my belief that in the coming years, more and more people will seek answers for society's ailments through the God of the Bible and the wisdom offered therein. And here is but one example. All of the turmoil of sexual brokenness in our society is addressed in these four verses that we study today. In the middle of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus addresses in four verses an issue so dangerous, so comprehensive and universal that he provides not only the diagnosis of the problem, but the drastic, radical remediation of the problem. Now, maybe you feel that my words have been too strong or judgmental or exaggerative, alarmist today. Just wait until you hear what Jesus has to say. Join me at Matthew chapter 5, beginning in verse 27. Matthew 5 and verse 27 says this. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. As he does throughout the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus takes an existing foundational truth of the law, and then he expounds on it. For a society that glorified external behavior and piety, Jesus goes deeper, and he addresses the intentions of the heart. The seventh commandment instructs that people are not to have sexual relations with someone to whom they aren't married. Simple enough, right? Well, Jesus goes to the motivations behind adultery and uncovers the deeper catalyst of adultery, lust. Bible scholar R.T. France defines lust in these terms, the deliberate harboring of desire for an illicit relationship. And on the surface, that is the essence of lust. But it's far more deeper and more insidious than this. And that's how we can make a case for the decay of morality that we are presently experiencing being attributed specific to this one thing, lust. New Testament scholar Craig Keener describes it this way. Jesus refers not to noticing a person's beauty, but to imbibing it, meditating on it, seeking to possess it. Lust is antithetical to true love. It dehumanizes another person into an object of passion, leading us to act as if the other were a visual or emotional prostitute for our use. Fueled by selfish passion, adultery violates the sanctity of another person's being and relationships. Adultery usually involves considerable rationalization, justifying one's behavior as necessary or loving. But lust is the mother of adultery, the demonic force that allows human beings to justify exploiting one another sexually, at the same time betraying the most intimate of commitments, where trust ought to abide secure. The concept behind lust is the same concept behind our human appetite. If we give ourselves over to eating whatever we want, we will be guided by that which brings us pleasure, the most pleasure. In turn, our brain and body will only crave more and more of it. The health crisis in our world today mirrors the sexual decline of society, and that people exercising their personal autonomy have thrown off caution and given themselves over to whatever and as much of whatever they desire. In the same way that diabetes is often the outcome of poor dietary choices and excessive sugar intake, the outcomes of lust are all forms of sexual deviance and increased forms of relational and mental instability. We see it all around us in the world today. As many of you know, my wife and I embarked upon a detox diet at the beginning of April. We've completed 5 weeks on the plan, and we've lost significant weight, but that wasn't the express purpose of the detox. It was instead to have a reset in our metabolism that had become dependent on carbs and processed sugars. I gotta tell you, folks, the first week was rough. We were not only breaking old habits and patterns, we were denying ourselves in a myriad of ways. My brain and body began to rebel against me. It was truly a detox from the poison that I had been feeding myself. And while I was starving my passions and desires that were actually biological responses of my brain and body, I recognized that I was deferring pleasure for a greater good, for a healthier outcome. What I once again was able to prove to myself is that my appetite is not my God. It doesn't rule over me. I can control the strong impulses to control my appetite and control what I do and how I respond. And this is the point that Jesus makes here. Your biological and sexual impulses are not your identity. They do not rule over you. Lust is the giving over of your rightful control and really God's lordship to indulge in something that will provide a momentary dopamine hit and make you feel temporarily better. But like every drug, our bodies are wired to desire more and more, and we will therefore be required to offer more and more of ourselves to our lustful cravings. How do we turn from this? How do we get out of this? How do we rescue ourselves or be rescued from these lustful desires? Well, Jesus says, cut it off, literally. In no uncertain terms, Jesus is telling us to take complete and comprehensive action to address this issue of our souls. And why does he instruct us to do something so radical in this issue? Because life and death, heaven and hell, hang in the balance. This is not a joke. This is not a game. Lust is killing us, killing our marriages, our families, our society as a whole. It's that serious. And by the way, it's not me saying this. This is Jesus. Listen to his words beginning in verse 29. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body go into hell. You might remember that the last time you heard me talk about these words was several months ago when I preached on Matthew chapter 18. I talked about the importance of protecting the innocence of children based on Jesus' words in Matthew 18 verses 1 through 6. But then immediately following are these words that also appear here in Matthew chapter 5 verses 29 and 30. Let's not miss the comparison, church. God is serious about protecting the purity and innocence of children, and especially that you and I as adults would return and become like innocent children. as we grow in the grace and knowledge of God. As I said in that sermon, Jesus is speaking in hyperbole to describe the drastic nature of how to deal with lust and how our broken sexuality has done damage to our souls at levels that we may never fully comprehend. There are some who have taken these words literally, actually. Church Father Origen castrated himself to address the issue of lust in his souls, but then he discovered that that didn't accomplish what Jesus is addressing here. Jesus is talking here about an amputation of the spirit, not of the physical body. He's saying that we are to see lust and broken sexuality as so very dangerous to our present life and to our eternal destination that we are to prioritize our war against lust to levels that may even exceed our own understanding. We are to trust God and address these issues in the light of His grace and forgiveness so that we might be healed and set free and that we might be assured of our present freedom in Christ and secure in our eternal state in Him. So let's finish with this today, church, shall we? At the end of the day, I believe that you're going to take away from this message whatever you want to hear. And every message is that way, for that matter. If you're walking in the light of God's grace, this sermon will hopefully affirm and confirm you leaning into the healing that God has for all of us. But if you're not, maybe you'll feel angry or condemned or judged. Or if there's a particular area of life or an ideology that you support, then you'll feel that I was focused on attacking that. But what I hope you can do is to see through all of your own defenses to a God who loves you and who provides healthy parameters so that you and I can enjoy all of His gifts, including sex. It's my hope that in the coming months, we'll have more conversations about this at BCC, including a family table talk surrounding these important issues of human sexuality and morality. And in the end, that we would be able to see that God calls us to a life of innocence and purity, that He's provided for us those parameters so that we may enjoy and celebrate sex within the bounds of biblical covenant marriage. And if we will have the courage to stand against the shifting sands of culture and its anything-goes subjectivity, that we might find, as the Church of Jesus Christ, just like the early church, that will actually become a refuge for those who are seeking the safe haven of morality and purity and sanity offered in the pages of Scripture within the beauty of the Church of Jesus Christ. Oh, may we indeed rise to the occasion for such a time as this. My prayer for you today, before we close this service in prayer and with a song, is that you would look at your life and that you would see and understand that God wants good for you. And that so often when it comes to this area of human sexuality, that we color outside the lines and that we make choices based on our desires and pleasures and our insatiable lusts that go contrary to what God has for us. Can I invite you today? When we talk about the Lordship of Christ, it means He's Lord of all. Can I invite you today to submit even your sexuality to Christ? This is not about sexual orientation. This is about the sum total of sexuality. Saying, Lord, I agree and align with what Your Word says about me. And I want to find my identity not in my desires, not in my lusts, not in my preferences. I want to find my identity in You. This is what God has for you. This is what He died to give you. Pray with me if you would. Lord, we give You thanks and praise. We want to take a moment now, Lord, and pray for the world around us. We want to ask that You would be God in all of these things, that You would help us to see and hear and discern Your will, Your purpose for us. Lord, I pray that no one would walk away from this message today feeling condemned or beat up. This is not about people living up to Your standard. None of us can. But this is about us giving You Your rightful place in our lives. This is about us saying to You, God, we will honor You with our bodies. And Scripture is replete with instructions for that. We are to flee from sexual immorality. We are to flee from lust. We are to cut it off. And so I pray for everyone listening to this message today that they would hear that and that they would take that seriously, not so that we can be morally better than anyone else, but so that we can offer our lives in purity to you. You want to give us abundant life. You want us to be happy as you define it in the Sermon on the Mount. Lord, we know that purity is one of the core features of that. Would you help us to endeavor day by day to live lives of purity? Thank you for this. We honor you, Christ, in our hearts and our minds, but also in our bodies, that you might be glorified and that people might look at us and see something different. As the world spins out of control around us, as chaos seemingly reigns, may your church rise. We thank you for this. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, let me invite you to rise right where you are, and let's close our service today with a song of praise to God.
What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. And to this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, He will stay. And I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hope, my Shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price that has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hope, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released, I can sing, I am free, and not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for He has said that He will bring me home. And day by day, I know He will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hope, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. to my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. To this I hope, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.